Good morning once again, brothers and sisters in the Dhamma and Namo Buddhaya. Happy New Year once again to those I didn't have a chance to wish you last week. Before I begin my talk, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank Brother Edmund. Brother Edmund, please raise your hand. All the talks that you have heard every week from different speakers, right, is the good work of Brother Edmund and his team. That includes Brother Rudy, Sister Eileen, Sister Kim. They got to plan for the talk, right? Look for speakers, write to the speakers, and especially for overseas speakers, we could get permit, right, so that we can bring good Dhamma speakers for all of us to benefit. So shall we say sadhu to Brother Edmund? Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. And I must thank him for inviting me to talk. If you look back in the past 8 months or so, where Brother Edmund and his team has planned a talk, you notice that the topics are very diverse, right? Some of them tend to be repetitive, and I think it's good to be repetitive because it reinforces the Dhamma. You don't just learn one time, you got to sometime hear again and reinforce your understanding. And in the last 2-3 months or so, the topics are around the 10 paramis, the 10 perfections, right? We try to make it thematic so that progressively all of us are learning. And in this quarter, that means from January to March, we will try to focus around the Noble Eightfold Path. I think that is a good topic. And last week, Bhante Ratanasara has given an introduction. What I try to do today, I will not go into the detail of the Noble Eightfold Path because we leave it to the individual speakers in the coming weeks to dwell on the Eightfold Path. But I thought what could be interesting is we heard from so many teachers, right? But maybe you have, but some of us may not. How we put all these teachings together, right? And how to apply them, right? Because as you hear all these different teachings, right? How you put it into a framework that every day and every moment you can apply. So I have a suggestion here for you, right? And like any of all my Dhamma talk, I run my suggestion with my teacher, right? And in this case, I run it through with Bhante Chandavimala. I met him and says, what do you think if I put all this different teaching and look at it from this angle, does it make sense, right? So you know that it's been verified. So walking the path, what does it mean? Now, each of us are at different stage in our journey, right? For me, I'm about 60 years old, right? And I want to share with you something interesting. Last week, one of the Dhamma brother sent me a WhatsApp, and it's an interesting statistics. Whether to believe or not is another thing, but I thought it was interesting. It's the statistics that show retirement age versus how long more you got to live. So now I look at that statistics, okay? If I retire this year, because I'm still working, if I decided to quit this year at the age of 60, I have 15 more years to live. Oh, that's interesting. But anyway, that's just statistics that one of my brothers shared with me. So the question is, do we know how long more we got to go? We don't know. But do we know what happened at the end? Right, and how prepared you want to be when that point comes. But more important is what do you do between now and then, right? During the early stage of our life, our goals tends to be a bit easier. And I want to share with you some personal example, right? When I left university, at that time, I joined IBM and subsequently Hewlett Packard, my goal was very clear. I tell myself, in 10 years' time, I want to be the general manager of a division. So we put a lot of effort to achieve that. And many of us do. It's a part of our early years when we are young and very ambitious, right? And then you climb up the corporate ladders. But along the way, you discover that, wow, it consumes a lot of your energy. Is that what you want? Right? So this is a question that we're going to ask ourselves, right? Because every year, you know, as we go through all this zodiac animal, right, we get caught into all this, you know, desire. Some of them call quality of life. And my boss used to like to use this term called quality of life. So what is quality of life? Having a happy family, is that quality of life? Having good friends that every weekend we can play games together, or being rejoiceful, or once a year we go on a holiday, feel peace at ease with ourselves. Every Sunday you come here, listen to Dharma talk, very peaceful. Is that quality of life? Or at work, where we move up the career ladder, or even at home with little quarreling, or our health, is that quality of life? Right, we ask ourselves. If I go a little bit more extreme, I just ladies example, no offense, but just for the point of illustration, right? Or we go on holidays, right? Or we take up a hobby, right? Or we find some way to entertain ourselves, right? Through music, or, you know, very common in Singapore these days, every community center that I know of has a Chinese singing group. Those, right? In fact, it's quite good, because it keeps them occupied. And I always say they sing all those mountain songs. It's quite interesting. So we keep ourselves occupied, right? And sometimes, okay, each of you, you go and check in your toilet. How much, you know, you use this to combat against aging, just to keep yourself look young, even for the guys, right? So are these the quality of life that we are talking about? That's the big question. So we tend to follow the crowd, right? But the challenge is when you follow the crowd, you normally don't get any further than the crowd, right? When you try to walk the path yourself alone, you discover you go to places that you have never been before. And many of us have seen that, right? And I have friends who go to South America, Africa, and you see wonders, right? And you see beautiful things. However, the road is a lonely journey, because your friends or your family members may walk with you. However, no one can walk for you. Yeah, you got to decide the path and you got to walk yourself. So now the question is, what is this path? What is the path of deliverance? Right? And how to make it stick so that you can always remember? So what I'm attempting to do in this talk here is to use analogy so that we can always remember. Right? Now, before that, we must know there's a difference between knowing the path and walking the path. All my slides in this preparation is all from Google. In the past, when I prepare talk, I would go to the library, look for the material, take photograph, handwritten. Today, no need. Stay at home, Google, all the Dharma answer inside there, right? All the wonderful pictures that you see, you want a picture of the Noble Eightfold Path. Wow, thousands of pictures come out, plenty. You want to read text, you want to listen to audio, Google is, you know, it's really awesome. Right? No wonder Google price is so high. Right? However, the problem is that you can Google every day, but until you walk the path, right, you get lost. But the question is, you have so much information in Google, how you distill the information to the essence that you know how to walk the path, right? So we have listened to all this talk, right? The Four Noble Truths, the Eightfold Path, the Paticca Samuppada, which is the dependent origination, the three universal characteristics, anicca, dukkha, anatta, and so on. We have heard many of these things, but how you tie them together, So to do that, we need to figure out from this maze, right? When do we apply this particular teaching? Where does it lead us to? Why we take this path? Are we clear on our end goals, right? Who do we need to seek for help when we get stuck? And so on and so on. Right? So with that as the stage, let's begin the journey on learning how to walk the path. In order to walk the path, in order to travel any journey, you need a map. Right? You need some form of a map. So one way to look at it is apply the Noble Eightfold Path as a map. Right? Because the Noble Eightfold Path that is taught by the Buddha in the Dhammacakkappavattana Sutta, the first discourse of the Buddha at Benares, right? The Buddha explained, right, what is dukkha, tanha, and nibbana. But more importantly, in fact, of the four, well, all the four truths are important, but the one that really helped us to overcome our difficulty is a Noble Eightfold Path. So you take that as a map, right, which I will elaborate later. Now, I will not go into detail, but just to give you a gist. Now, this Noble Eightfold Path is not something that is invented by the Buddha. The Buddha did not think very hard, take a pen and a paper, and then design it. No, he did not design the Eightfold Path. He did not architect the Eightfold Path. This Eightfold Path is discovered by the Buddha. It has always been there. Right? The Buddha attained enlightenment and discovered it. And because he knew that this Noble Eightfold Path is the path that will lead us to liberation, hence, he taught it as the first teaching in the Dhammacakkappavattana Sutta. Right? You can look at this path in three broad categories, right? Panya, Sila, and Samadhi. Now, it's important to remember that in this path, you do not take them in any sequence. It doesn't mean that you finish right view, you can put them aside, then you go to right intention, you put them aside, and you go to the next one. It is not meant to be that way. You practice all of them in parallel, right? And you practice them again and again, coming back again and again, right? So, for example, in right view, you start with the right view of what? Of the Dhamma, that means the Four Noble Truths. Then as you go down the path, and as you practice that, you come back to right view again, you will look at it very differently. And I try to explain later. So, as you practice this path, you find yourself that mentally you'll be less agitated, right? You'll be more calm, right? And then you can see the truth and free yourself. So, the Buddha is like a doctor, right? Like you have heard about dukkha, right? And he prescribed, right? He diagnosed what is wrong. And in the second truth is called Samudaya, right? He discovered that tanha, craving, is the cause of all this dukkha that we are having, right? And the beauty is that in the third truth, which Nirodha, he says there is an end, right? And the end is called Nibbana, right? And there's a path, Magga, right? And the path is called the Noble Eightfold Path. All the teachings of the Buddha, right? Right, is revolving around this basic Four Noble Truths and Eightfold Path. Right. So let's talk a little bit about dukkha. Right. We all have seen, you have heard it many times, right? Birth, decay, disease, right? Or you don't want to be close to somebody you don't like, or even get separated from someone whom you love so much. There's so many different aspects of dukkha. Right? And the Buddha summarizes it and says, all the compounded things are subject to dukkha. Right? And tanya is that cause, the desire. Now, the desire can be desire for many things, not only about desire for wealth or power or pleasure, but also desire or the strong attachment to ideas. Have it not occurred to you, whether in your office or in your school or even your home, where you have a very strong attachment to certain projects or certain ideas or certain concepts, and you just want people to listen to you and accept your idea, and if they don't listen to your idea, oh, you get so upset. That is craving, right? So craving is not just about material. It's also about your belief, about your thoughts. All those are examples of craving, right? And the Buddha says, well, we can overcome all this because Nibbana is attainable. That's the beauty about it. So, at a high level, I capture this Noble Eightfold Path. In summary, it talks about, first, you must know the truth, and that's right view, or right understanding, as some put it. And once you understand the truth, then you can have the right intention, so that you're able to free your mind of the evil, right? And then you begin on the sila part, the next tree, the right speech, the right action, and the right livelihood is the sila part, the morality portion, right? Where you try not to say anything that hurts someone, or you do things good for the others, or have a good livelihood. And then you must put effort behind it, right? To such that you can overcome all the evenness, right? Then you can put into mindfulness practice, and finally, concentration. This is the global view. Now, a few concepts behind this Noble Eightfold Path. Firstly, they're all interlinked. You notice that's why it's like a wheel, right? They're all interdependent with one another. They are not, how should I say, they're not separated, right? They're all interdependent. And it's a wheel. It's a wheel because why? It repeats itself, right? It goes again and again. So the symbol is quite symbolic. Right? So remember, you take this as a map, right? Just like you have your Google map, this is your map to refer. Now, let me try to elaborate a little bit more on what it means, okay? Right view means firstly to have understanding of the Four Noble Truths. You got to start with something basic, right? So in all the previous talks, right, you heard about, you know, the dukkha, the tanha, the craving, nibbana. Have a good understanding of that, right? Because when you have a good understanding of that, then you can plan. You have the intention, right? The path you want to take. Now, in order to achieve, in order to let go of your attachment, right? Renunciation must be one of your intention, right? Now, renunciation as a layman doesn't mean that all of us here give up and become monk or nun. Not necessarily. It doesn't mean that. It means renounce your attachment, whether attachment to all your strong views or your strong thoughts or even your possession, right? So the ability to start planning and have that in your intention. At the same time, have the intention to develop loving kindness and compassion. That is right intention. Okay? So this too is being classified as panya. Now, I'll come back to that again. Then the next three bucket, right, is about right speech, right action, and right livelihood, right? So right speech, right, fundamentally the four things to remember is about not telling lies, no slandering, no harsh work, and idle chatter. Now, I think in my mind today, idle chatter today is the most difficult. Because of why? Because of this, WeChat, WhatsApp, Instagram, we chatter a lot, right? So that is something we got to overcome, right? And to replace them with wholesome speech, something that is truthful, gentle, pleasing to hear, and so on, right? So that's right speech. The right action is some aspect of the five precepts, right? No killing, no stealing, and sexual misconduct. The five precepts. And right livelihood means try to practice the five precepts in your daily life, right? So these three, right, forms the sila. Now, this sila is always important because if you don't have very strong sila, you cannot go to the next group, right, which is samadhi, right? Because if your sila is not strong, what happens? You tend to worry, right? See, oh boy, what happened because I didn't do this thing right? What happened because I've hurt somebody? Because your mind is so preoccupied with the things that you didn't do right because you lack the sealer, it's very hard to go into somebody. That's why they always emphasize you have right sealer. Then you can go into the somebody, which is the right effort, the mindfulness, and the concentration. Right? In the right effort, you think in terms of two buckets, the wholesome and the unwholesome. Right? In the right effort right now is for those unwholesome deeds, right, you prevent the unwholesome deed from arising. Right? It takes a lot of effort, no? To in your thoughts, all the funny thoughts to prevent them from arising takes a lot of effort. But if they should arise, it takes a lot of effort to abandon them. It's not easy because we get so easily attached to it. Right? That's the unwholesome part. On the wholesome part, it takes just as much effort, right, to generate wholesome thought and maintain it. Right? That's what right effort means. Okay, in the Noble Eightfold Path. With that effort, then you can go and practice the four foundations of mindfulness. Right? The four foundations of mindfulness is the body, the feeling, the mind, and the mental object. So what do you mean when you try to be mindful of the body? Well, you did that just now, right? You are observing your breath. That's your body. That's part of your body. Yeah, you're very conscious. When Bhante Kovida was here, he teach you dynamic meditation, which is be conscious of, you know, your bodily movement, right? That is an example of mindfulness on the body. Mindfulness of the feelings, no, your emotions, right? How are you feeling? Calm? Disappointed? Happy? Right? That's the mindfulness of the feeling. Or the mind, how agitated your mind is, right? That's your observation, mindful of the mind. Or the mental object, which is the Dhamma itself. Do you understand the Noble Eightfold Path? Right. So that's how you apply the practice of mindfulness. When you understand all these things, then when you apply concentration, your mind will be very focused and you'll be able to attain the four jhanas. When you achieve this, when you go back to right view again, as I say, it's a cycle, it goes back again, then this time, when you look at right view, you will look at it very different when you first started it. Because when you first started it, you're trying to understand what is the Four Noble Truths and Eightfold Path. But as you go through this journey, and you experience the journey, because you put your sila into practice, you put your samadhi into practice, when you go back to right view, you see things as they truly are. That's why I put bracket there as a result of practice. You understand the truth of self. That is the map that I'm talking about. Now, having a map is good, but to get to your destination, you need a compass, right? In the past, they look at the stars, right? Okay, maybe today we all use Google again. But in the practice, you need some form of a compass, right? That compass is the virtues that you hold to yourself, right? The four Brahma Vihara, right? The loving kindness, the compassion, the equanimity, and the joy. It serves like a booster, right, into your practice of the Noble Eightfold Path. So when you practice the Noble Eightfold Path, right, at the same time, the state of your mind, right, is to always be like the four Brahma Viharas. That you cultivate them. So in order to cultivate this very wholesome state of mind and to have this attitude, right, then the way to do it is through meditation. Right? To meditate on the loving kindness, the compassion, the joy, and the equanimity. Right? And when you meditate on all these things, right, as the picture trying to show, eventually you should reach out to all sentient beings. Right? It is only when you practice it to the extent of reach out to all sentient beings, then indeed it is called immeasurable. You cannot measure. Right? The moment you stop at your family member, you're measuring because that's where you put your boundary is. Right? So yesterday I was giving a talk to the Buddhist youth. I told them immeasurable means also your enemy. Very, very difficult. But that is immeasurable because you include your enemy. Right? It also includes strangers, people you do not know, right? And it even includes the animal kingdom. That is immeasurable, right? So when you can do that, then you overcome the ill will, you overcome the cruelty, right? You overcome the jealousy and the desire. So that's a broad concept. So let's go a little bit detail on the four Brahmavihara. So the Buddha told Rahula, and that's what the Buddha says, why you practice loving kindness? Because you want to overcome the anger inside you, the ill will and the hatred and delusion. Right? Because if you can overcome all this anger, the ill will and the hatred, right, then you have the capacity to generate loving kindness to all. Why you practice compassion? Because you want to overcome the cruelty inside you so that you have the capacity to help as many sentient beings as possible to remove from their suffering. Why do you practice appreciative joy or sympathetic joy? Because then you overcome the hatred inside you, right? Because you always rejoice in happiness of others, even in the happiness of your enemy. And you practice equanimity because you want to overcome prejudice, because you look at all things in fairness and equally. Right? So let's try to dwell a little bit more because I think this is important. Now, metta. So when you practice metta or loving kindness, it's without any exception, right? It is unconditional. So let me try to explain using example what I mean by conditional love. So the example I want to use here is about the mother. Right, so when the mother wishes her son good health, wish her son have good friends, be intelligent, be successful, the mother is very happy. Right, likewise, for many of us, we always wish our friend good health. Right, somebody WhatsApp and says, "Oh, my father is sick or I'm not well." You always wish, right, well and happy. Right, however, such loving kindness is conditional. Right, because knowingly or unknowingly, there's some form of attachment. Right? As quoted in my fifth bullet, let me quote, I love you because you make me feel good. I love you as long as you do things that I approve of. I love you because you're mine. You're my spouse, my children, my parents, and so on. That is not the kind of loving kindness because those are very conditional. Right? And when it's conditional, it goes up and down. Right? Because you always try to please somebody. When the Buddha talks about metta, he's talking about unconditional love. That means don't expect anything in return, right? You detach, right? You have no agenda. You love somebody because you purely love somebody. There's no agenda attached, right? You simply want people to be happy. You are so sincere that you really want to help other people to be happy. Only when you do that, right, to every sentient being, right, to strangers, to the enemy, then indeed it is called immeasurable because there's no boundary. That's why it's Brahmavihara. Brahma is immeasurable. Right? So I want to quote you a couple of examples here. One is from the Dikha Nikaya number 13, right? Where the Buddha says, right, in all direction, right, north, south, east, west, above, below, all around you, right, you feel your heart the loving kindness, so abundant, right, is measureless, free from enmity, free from distress. That's what the teachings of the metta, right? Or by Nagarjuna. Nagarjuna is one of the very famous Buddhist philosophers. Even you offer 300 bowls of food 3 times a day, it does not match the spiritual merit gain in just one moment of love. So if that love is so sincere, you notice how powerful that love is, right? You know, in the Buddha story, right, where the Buddha used loving kindness to stop Nalagiri from charging towards him. Right? That's the power of loving kindness. Right? The group of monks came to the Buddha because they were having difficulty doing meditation, right, in a cemetery. And the Buddha taught them the Karanya Metta Sutta. Right? And they overcome all those. That's the power of loving kindness when it is sincere. Right? Or like what the Dalai Lama quoted. Right? If there's love, there's hope that you can have real, real families, real brotherhood, real equanimity, real peace. However, if it's lost and you see others as enemy, then no matter how knowledgeable you are, right, then only suffering and confusion will always follow. So how you practice loving kindness, right? You may have heard in one of the talks, right? Begin with yourself, right? You cannot love other people until you love yourself, right? You got to begin with yourself first, right? And wish yourself to be happy, right? Then you radiate that loving kindness to those very close around you because it's easier, right? So when you do practice, right, you do with something that's easier first, right? With yourself, with your close ones, right? Maybe after that, your neighbor, their community, in Singapore, right? Then to strangers and to enemy. Because when you gradually practice this way, when you radiate loving kindness to strangers and to enemy, it's so much easier because you have built it gradually, right? Then we come to karuna. Karuna is where we are trying to help others to be free from suffering, right? So the opposite of karuna is cruelty, right? Now, there's this concept called near enemy. That means you think that karuna is about pity, but actually it is not, right? So just like loving kindness, you have ordinary compassion. Take, for example, the mother, right? When you see the son is ill. Obviously, the mother is moved and trying to hope that the son can recover and free from suffering. You feel like it's compassion, right? Or your good friend is suffering, and you're so full of compassion. But that's a little bit more emotional, right? Ultimate compassion is, again, just like loving kindness. It's unselfish. There's no expectation. Detached emotion. And again, to everybody, right? To strangers and to your enemies, right? And even to people in other realm. Then it is indeed immeasurable. That is what we want. So the quote from the Buddha in Dikha Nikaya number 13, the Buddha says the same thing. In all directions, right? Feel yourself to be everywhere. Feel your heart with compassion, abundant, measureless, free from enmity, and free from distress. Right? And in the Mahayana, you have seen that concept in Kuan Yin, right? In Avalokiteshvara, right? Where she made a vow to herself, right? That she's going to help all sentient beings, right? Before she strive to attain Nibbana. Right? Or by Bhikkhu Nyanaponika, and I quote, "It is compassion that removes the heavy bar, opens the door to freedom, makes the narrow heart as wide as the world. Compassion takes away from the heart the inert weight, the paralyzing heaviness. It gives wings to those who cling to the loneliness of self." Right? So these are good quotes. So how you practice compassion? You can begin with someone whom you have compassionate about, right? As your early start of your practice, right? Because it's easier that way. Then you can then take further steps, you know, to your relative, to your friends, to your strangers, and to your enemy. And just like loving kindness, again, I like to emphasize, you got to practice to all the sentient beings. That's to what extent you practice karuna. Mudita is about being happy for somebody, right? And it counter what we call jealousy, and it make you less self-centered, okay? Now, in just like the other two, there's a danger of what you call, I call it a common apparitive joy, right? Just like the mother is so happy that the son graduated from university, right? That is not really appreciative joy, right? There's a bit of attachment inside there, right? Or you are so happy at your friend's fortune. Is it genuine happiness or a little bit of expectation or attachment, right? But in the sublime appreciative joy, right, there's no expectation. It's very unselfish, very positive mental attitude to benefit other people. You rejoice in the spiritual progress, right, who of your friends who have accomplished anything, right? Sometimes against ideas or things that you may not be approved of, but you're sincerely happy because you're happy for them, right? On your friend's spiritual path, or your friends who have attained higher rebirth, right? So when you extend that spiritual, appreciative joy to that extent, indeed, it is immeasurable. Now, a point which I want to raise, what's the difference between praising somebody and appreciative joy? We like to praise people, right? Oh, you have done a wonderful job, right? And we see a lot of that, right? Now, in appreciative joy, it doesn't mean that you got to praise. It means deep down inside you, you are so happy, sincerely happy on the accomplishment and the success of that person, right? On his spiritual progress or even his material progress, right? So it is the condition that you develop. Because when you do that, what happened is you are letting go of attachment, right? You are able to achieve that kind of loving kindness, that kind of compassion, that kind of mudita, appreciative joy. You notice that once it becomes immeasurable, you don't have any condition attached to it, right? You're not expecting anything. You are very sincere about it. That is the compass that what I'm talking about, right? That's the guide, right? And so how you practice appreciative joy, right? Begin with someone who is close to you. It's easier that way. Then you can extend to other people. Again, to your relative, strangers, and to enemies. And finally, to all sentient beings. So the last one is on upekkha. Now, upekkha is not easy. It's about treating everybody as equal. Very hard, right? Right? You treat your best friend and your enemies or somebody you don't like as equal. It's very hard, right? Because you have emotion. That's why the early part of the Brahma Vihara and the practice on the loving kindness, right, helps when you come to upekkha. Because when you come to that state, when your mind is very tranquil, right, then you don't have any attachment. You don't have any clinging. Right? Because equanimity is about overcoming clinging and overcoming aversion. Right? The danger is being indifferent, so avoid that. Okay? So again, common equanimity, like the mother, right? You know, when the mother sees the son very successful, settled down, lead an independent life, the mother says, okay, fine, I can leave you aside. Right? So you thought that, okay, that's equanimity, but really it's not equanimity, right? Equanimity where you are really, your mind is in balance, right? You have no discrimination against anyone, right? And it's very rooted, right, in all the earlier Brahma Vihara, because your love is so unconditional, right? It's so altruistic, right? You're not attached to anything. Then that is indeed immeasurable. Right? So the quote here, from the Buddha, the Dikha Nikaya, the Buddha said the same thing in all direction. See, every time in many of the Buddha teaching, he always likes to say in all directions. And all directions include up and below, right? And all the six directions. See? So that's where you radiate all your Brahma Vihara, right? In terms of upekkha, fill your heart with equanimity, abundant, grown great, measureless, free from enmity, free from distress. That's what you have to practice, right? Or another quote, if one tries to befriend an enemy for a moment, then he becomes your friend. But the same thing occurs when one treats a friend as an enemy, because that is just temporal relation, right? The wise is never attached to the food, the clothing, or the reputation, or even to friends and enemies, okay? Then I want to quote from the Dalai Lama, without the foundation of a mind of equanimity, you are not be able to have impartial altruistic view, because without equanimity, you will always have partiality towards your friends and relatives. And realize that you should not have prejudice, hatred, or desire towards your enemy, friends, and neutral person. That is a firm foundation of equanimity. So to practice equanimity is the other way around. Right? It's easier to practice equanimity with a stranger. Right? Than to have equanimity with someone who is so close to you. Because when you practice equanimity with someone close to you, sometimes you get mixed up with the attachment of that person. So you start with a stranger, right? And then, because you have less of a strong feeling, and then eventually you extend again to relatives, friends, enemies, and so on. Okay? So, when you practice all these four Brahma Vihara, start where it is easiest for you, right? Because then you will overcome that four things, right? The loving kindness will help you to overcome the evil. The compassion will help you to overcome the cruelty. The appreciative joy will overcome the jealousy, and the equanimity will overcome the desire. So that's why when you practice these four Brahma Vihara, when you do the meditation, like the way I mentioned earlier, That's what you're overcoming. When you do that, and that is your compass in you, right? Then you find wherever you are, at home, in school, in work, right? You will always be surrounded by good friends, right? Because people can feel it around you, right? And that will lead you to a better rebirth, right? So I just want to capture important. This is a summary here, right? What I said. You know, look at metta. You want to overcome anger. But there's this thing called attachment, right? The conditional love, right? So that's the danger you've got to be careful of. We call it the near enemy. Or the sympathetic joy to overcome jealousy, right? But the near enemy is a blind euphoria, right? So you've got to be careful of that. Or karuna, you want to overcome cruelty, but sometimes in your practice of compassion, you get so depressed, right? So that's what you want to avoid, right? Or upekkha, you want to overcome your prejudice, but sometimes you say, okay, tidak apa, indifference. But that's what you want to avoid. Those are the near enemies. Okay? And it just doesn't happen like that, right? It got to be cultivated, which is what I'm trying to say. You got to experience it yourself, right? So when you try to infuse the Noble Eightfold Path with the Four Brahma Vihara in your thought, in your speech, and your action, whatever you do, right? Taking care of your family, many of us doing volunteer work, helping a friend, helping a stranger, right? The practice of your Noble Eightfold Path, right? Always include inside it the four measurables. Then it make your action pure and wholesome, right? You try to do it. You compare your mundane action, right, with and without the immeasurables and see the difference, right? And then you can really understand with and without what it means, right? And the outcome that you get, right, will be a lot of positive thought. You have peacefulness, you have sukha, you have piti, which is joy, right? You grow spiritually, and your relationship, right, or your friendship will be so much harmonious. And you get mundane growth along the way. Right? Now, I want to explain this tornado effect, because when you practice with the four Brahma Vihara, it's what I call very infectious radiation. You know, a tornado, according to science, right? A tornado, in terms of energy, you can power the whole country for 50 years. That's the power of tornado. Likewise, it's the power of the four immeasurables. Right? Let's tell you the magnitude of what this practice of the Noble Eightfold Path as your guide and the four Brahma Vihara as your compass, right, will create that kind of energy. And it will spread. It's so infectious because your friend seeing you practice will follow you and it will just get the cyclic effect. Right? So, recently one of the monks was explaining to me about this transformation of a metal sheet. A piece of metal, yeah, you put on the water, it sinks, right? Flat, it sinks. That same piece of metal, you mold it into a shape of a bowl, it floats. It's the same thing. That's you, right? When you mold it, it floats. Better still, now you can put things on top of the bowl and it still floats, right? So when you fill yourself with the four Brahma Vihara, it floats and it benefits, becomes very light and benefits many people. Okay, so I've shared with you two things. You have a map, which is your Noble Eightfold Path, and you have a compass to guide you on your journey, right? But just like when you travel from Singapore to KL, you stop somewhere, right? Maybe you stop at Malacca, halfway. You don't travel one straight. You take intermediate stops, right? So likewise, even in projects that you do, right? You first design your project, then, you know, you develop it, then you test it. So what you're doing is you're setting milestones, right? So likewise, you need to set milestones. Otherwise, you'll get burnt out. Because to attain Nirvana is just not just chiong. You got to set milestone. That milestone that you can help you to set are your 10 paramis, which you have learned in the past 2 to 3 months. Right? These 10 paramis, take it as your intermediate milestones, right? And then apply the Noble Eightfold Path, and the compass, the four Brahma Vihara, right? To achieve each of the paramis. Right? Because the paramis can be something that's attained. The Buddha, through his many, many births, right, practice the parami till perfection. Right? So you have heard about these 10 paramis. Let us quickly go through, okay? These paramis are just like the act, right, for us to practice. Or they're the simple truth that you can apply in your everyday life. Or you can consider them as guidelines, right? So they're posts, you know, milestones, they're posts, right? That you can decide how you want to reach them. Maybe some of them is this week or this month or whatever is it. You set for yourself because the path is your path and no two paths are the same, right? So let's start with the first one, generosity. Whether is it in the Theravadan tradition or even in the Mahayana tradition, generosity is always number one, right? So when you practice generosity, you even practice to the extent that you don't even have enough, you still give. That is called perfection, right? You can say, yeah, I got 100,000 in my bank account, I give $10,000 away. Yeah, true, you practice generosity. But when you practice parami means perfection. You have 100,000 in your account, you give away $100,000. About 3 weeks ago, I met a friend. Not met, but through another friend. This guy is like that. His bank account is literally not much. Whatever goes in, goes out. I say, you don't need to plan. You don't need. Because my dana parami is so strong. You know what happened? He's always surrounded by friends who buy him makan. It's serious. This is a true story. He always surrounded by friends who pay for his tour, who pay for his holiday. Because he's so sincere in his practice of the parami. But to do that, you got to use the Noble Eightfold Path, right? You have a right view, right? Your right view says, I have 100,000 in my bank account. Wow. And you want to practice your four Brahma Vihara. How to be immeasurable when you say, I got to keep 90,000 because I got to worry for the next 15 years of my life. I got the food to eat. But he's immeasurable. I'm just illustrating on how people practice this. That's dana. Right? Morality, you do the right thing even if no one is watching you. Right? You don't only do the right thing when people are watching you. Right? When you have morality, you do things what is right. Right? So that you can be free from all the desires. Now, renunciation, as you heard, is about renounce things which are worthy. Let go. Right? Not just about let go of the material things, no. It's let go your concept, your idea. Sometimes you go on a family gathering or a club gathering and you insist you want your own way because that's the best way. That's attachment. Right? Learn to let go. Right? And wisdom, right? To hold discernment in your heart. But all this requires energy. You know, our whole body is filled with energy, right? So it's how you direct the energy in your body so that you can do the right things. But it's not easy because it requires a lot of patience. Right? The patience can be one of your milestones. Sometimes you give and take and you learn to accept other people. Right? And later on, I show you a video. It'll be quite interesting. Right? Now, truthfulness. Now, this is tough. Right? How to say the right word no matter what it costs. You know, sometimes we are so concerned about trying not to hurt somebody, right? That we package our words so nicely. But in truthfulness, you say what you think is right. But of course, you have to say it in the right speech. There mean no harsh words. Say it sweetly, sweet, gently, but the message gets across. Right? Now, determination is also another 10 parami, right? Where when you walk the path, your mind is very firm. Right? Now, my one example of determination which I want to share is being vegetarian. It took me so hard to become a vegetarian. Right? And now, when I have dinner with my friends, even though my daughter likes to eat steak. So when I go dinner, I'll take the cauliflower, he'll take the steak. Right. That's an example of determination. Right. Okay, loving kindness and equanimity we talk about. Those are the 10 paramis as well. Right. So what I want to say, this slide sort of summarize it. Right? Summarize it because the eightfold path, right? Always remember that's your map, right? Guided by the compass, the four Brahma Vihara, right? And then you map out. Because now you have the map and then you have the compass. Then as you practice your 10 paramis, you decide your milestone, right? To what extent you want to achieve, and then make progression. Because when you do that, right, then you can attain the four stages of sainthood, right? Starting with Sotapanna, right? Sakadagami, Anagami, and finally Arahantship. That is what we are striving for. That is the goal we want. Right? Now, of course, there's a lot more teachings to it, but I'm trying to capture the main one, put it into this framework so that it's easier to understand. Now I want to show you one slide, right? Which is a bit more complicated. So for that, I need to stand up, right? Let me try my best to guide you to read this slide because it's in some way it summarizes my discussion, but it's a funny way to end the Dhamma sharing with such a slide. So you have dukkha, right? And those are examples of dukkha. And then you have the cause of dukkha. And then you have the path, right? Leading to Nibbana, right? Which is a Four Noble Truth. It's at the top. It encapsulates all the essence of the Dhamma at the top. Okay? When you attain Nibbana, you find yourself in the four sublime attitude, the four Brahma Vihara. It's to perfection. It's immeasurable. That's why I say, you know, your loving kindness, compassion, appreciative joy, and equanimity, make it as part of your practice because that's what you want to achieve. Right? And that will give you a glimpse and taste of the end point. Then the sila is important because in the Noble Eightfold Path, you have the sila, right? So for us as lay people, it's a five precept. For the monks, they have their own vinaya, right? But the sila is not good enough. You must have meditation, which is why you have the samadhi, right? The right effort, the right mindfulness, and the right concentration. These two must go hand in hand, right? If your sila is not strong, when you practice your samadhi, right, then you're beginning to see the truth, the middle way, right? When you understand the truth, when you have the right view and right intention, because you go back again, right, to the right view, then you understand the five aggregates, the five khandhas, which was in one of the previous talk. You really understand what the five khandhas are about because you're beginning to have a right wisdom. And you find that the right aggregates, right, will result. Because of these five aggregates, it results in all this attachment, right? And also because of this, you find that these five aggregates are the consequence of the three universal characteristics, anicca, anatta, and dukkha. Right? So you imagine that when you practice all these things diligently, right, you begin to understand what is the five aggregate. You begin to understand the three universal characteristics. You begin to understand the 12 dependent origination. Right. So what we hope in the rest of the Dhamma talk, we can hopefully bring you on this journey bit by bit, right, so that we can understand. This is just a bird's eye view. Okay. So let me conclude by sharing with you one video which I saw it quite recently. Have you seen this video? Or some of you have, is it?
His doctor, who always accompanied him on a hunt, put a bandage. Once upon a time, a king was out hunting when he injured his finger. His doctor, who always accompanied him on a hunt, put a bandage on the wound. Is it going to be all right? The king asked the doctor. The doctor replied, good, bad, who knows? By the time he got back from the hunt, the wound had become infected. The doctor carefully cleaned the wound, put some ointment on it, and bandaged it again. Are you sure it's going to be all right? Asked the king. Good, bad, who knows, said the doctor. A few days later, the finger became so infected they had to amputate it. The king was so furious with the doctor that he threw him into the dungeon. See how you like being in jail, doctor? The doctor said, prison, sire. Good, bad, who knows? The king told him, you are insane as well as incompetent. A few weeks later, the king went out hunting again. But this time, he got lost and was captured by the indigenous forest people. It was their holy day, and they needed a sacrifice for their gods. They tied the king to a tree and started dancing and chanting around him. And just as they were about to slit his throat, the priest yelled, stop! This man cannot be our sacrifice. He is not perfect. He's only got 9 fingers. And so they set him free. The king went straight to the dungeon the moment he got back to the palace, and he apologized profusely to the doctor. You were right, he said. Losing my finger was good. You saved my life. I am so sorry. It was bad of me to have put you in this dungeon. And the doctor said, bad? It was very good that you locked me here. Otherwise, I would have been with you on the hunt. And I have all my 10 fingers. When something undesirable happens to us, it's hard to think that anything positive can come out from it. But there's always a reason for everything. And sometimes we just don't see the reason yet. Don't categorize things into good or bad, because who knows how the universe is conspiring to help us. An arrow can only be shot by pulling it backwards. So when life is pulling you back with difficulties, it means that it's going to launch you into something great. So stay focused and keep aiming and be happy always.